Most Reverend Pablo, Virgilio, David, Bishop of Caloocan.
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters. Good afternoon, Eminence, Excellencies, the Reverend Fathers here present. Mga kapatid, we're gonna have them all. I have been requested to share some thoughts on the topic Communion of Communities, Clergy, Lay Collaboration. And so I intend to present this sharing this afternoon as two points. The first being Communion of Communities. What exactly do we mean by that? And secondly, Clergy, Lay Collaboration. Let me begin immediately with the very first part. Communion of communities. Actually, the inspiration for this is the topic or the theme that is recommended by the Catholic Bishops' Conference of the Philippines for this year in preparation for 2021, the celebration of the 500th year of Christianity. The theme for this year is the parish. The parish as communion of communities. And you know, I am addressing you, brothers and sisters, in the Couples for Christ. I am sure you know that there are some parish priests who are allergic to CFC. There are some parish priests who are allergic to charismatic communities for that matter, especially when they hear the word transparochia. Some parish priests feel threatened by groups like you because they're always afraid that if you enter their parish, you are only looking for members whom you will pull out of their parish and who will be more loyal to your transparochial community than to the parish community. And I hope you're aware of that. There is such a hazard and there is such a baggage to the mind of many parish priests. But you know, communion of communities is not just about the parish. It is about the church. It is what being church means. To be church is to be a communion of communities. Now, I would like to ask, sincerely, you know, if our parishes are communities, let me not preempt that. Let me just move on. I think we are all aware of the basic misnomer about church. Church understood as a place of worship. Let us go to church. So when people say church, they mean the building, the place of worship. And sometimes another misnomer is when media people will ask a question like, what is the stand of the church? And almost always what they mean is what is the stand of the clergy or what is the stand of the bishops. When bishops make a stand, for them, that is the church already. But bishops are members of the clergy and the clergy don't make up the whole church. So, is it automatic that when a bishop makes a pronouncement, he is speaking for the church? Not necessarily always so. The diocese is one of the most beautiful expressions of the local church as a communion of communities, and the smaller communities that are in communion with one another under the leadership of the bishop are the parish communities. The local church, which you call the diocese, is a communion of communities. But the communities in dioceses are not always just the parishes. Sometimes in the diocese, you would have school communities, you would have contemplative communities, you would have other religious communities, you would have covenanted communities, but they are part of the same diocese. And the symbol of communion is the bishop. Now, what about our parishes? There is no doubt that our parishes are institutions and are very old institutions, as old as the diocese as an institution. But my question is, when we speak of parishes, are we really speaking about communities? We have a problem with the word parish nowadays. It has come to develop a very negative meaning. You know, the word parochial is not positive in the dictionary. Check it out in your dictionary. Parochial is negative. And when they say you have a parochial mentality, you're not supposed to take that as a compliment. I feel very bad about that. I do not know why the word parish or parochial has come to assume a very negative meaning. There must be something to that that we should understand. You know, the original sense of the word parochia in Tagalog is from the Greek word paroikia. And you know, the real meaning of paroikia is a stopover, a temporary sojourn. If you are traveling to the United States, and you're traveling by a Hong Kong, you have a stopover in Hong Kong. Meaning Hong Kong is not your destination. It is just a stopover. And if you have a long overlay, you might even need a hotel accommodation. That is what you call a temporary sojourn. It is an inn for weary travelers. Coming up? Okay. I've been talking like, you know, presuming that you have been seeing what I've been flashing on the screen, but I don't have to be like that. All right. The original sense of the parochia is the Greek parochia, a temporary sojourn, an inn for weary travelers. Wow, that's beautiful. You know, the Old Testament thoughts have come close to the oasis idea. If you are traveling in the desert, you are familiar with the stories in the book of Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, up to Deuteronomy about the journey of the Israelite people in the desert. And every now and then, they had to make a stopover in an oasis. Sometimes they probably felt like, you know, not carrying on with the journey anymore. When you're tired with the journey, sometimes you feel like, why don't we just settle here, you know? But an oasis is just a stopover. It is a parochia. Let's look for some New Testament applications. In the Gospel of St. Luke, we're told that Mary and Joseph were on their way to Bethlehem. And there was no space, no place for them in any parochia, in any of the inns. That is why the Son of God was born in a stable for animals. There would be other texts in the New Testament about the parochia, like in Luke chapter 10. You're familiar with the story of the parable of the Good Samaritan. The parochia there is the place where the victim is brought by the Good Samaritan so that the victim could recuperate and carry on with his journey. And in Luke chapter 24, which you are all surely familiar with, there is the story about the two disciples who are met by a stranger. Parokia is the place where they broke bread together so that their eyes were opened and they recognized Jesus. And of course, the best image of the parokia would be the upper room. The upper room is the place where Jesus celebrated Passover with his disciples before carrying on with his journey to Calvary. It was just a stopover. Now, when Jesus resurrected, he gave instructions through the women that they should go and meet him in Galilee. But because they were so afraid and so traumatized, instead of going to Galilee, they stayed in the upper room. They locked the doors, they closed the windows, and they were afraid. Jesus had to break into that upper room in order to get them out, because that was not the ultimate destination. So the upper room there is the parokia, where the risen Jesus appeared and breathed new life into his disciples. You see the two points of the parokia. The parokia is the parokia, that temporary stopover for your journey. We are on a pilgrimage. You know, this morning, we celebrated with Cardinal Chito Tagle, and his homily was about pilgrimage, about the journey. Well, the church is a pilgrim community. We're not supposed to erect temples. What we have should be tents. The concept of the parokia should be like a pool, like a temporary dwelling place. But then we started to lose the original sense of the parokia when parishes became recreations of the Jerusalem temple. And it's very typical of parish priests to want to build as big a temple as possible. The original sense got lost when the ordained ministry became a reinvention of the Jewish temple priesthood, which is precisely the institution that has been, you know, overthrown by the priesthood of Christ, the one eternal high priesthood of Christ. You see, there are two main reasons for the deterioration of the meaning of the parish into something negative. One, parochialism, and two, clericalism. We have to deal with these two problems if we wish to return to the meaning of the church as communion of communities. In the parochialist sense, what is a parish? In the parochialist sense, a parish is an exclusive ghetto of Catholics. Catholics only, who associate only with each other and nobody else, who avoid the secular world, who avoid the company of non-Catholics, who are xenophobic, who avoid the company of non-Christians. That's the negative idea of that is the parochialist notion of the parish. When parishes began to look at themselves as the communities of the saved, instead of looking at themselves as a saving community. In the vocabulary of Pope Francis, this is the idea of the self-referential church, a church that is turned in on itself, a church that is concerned only with its own churchy affairs. Let me now refer you to a speech delivered by Cardinal Bergoglio before he got elected into the papacy. You know, Cardinal Bergoglio, before he became Pope Francis, joined the conclave. You know, his evidence is here. I don't know if he was a witness to this, because you were a participant in the conclave. I am told that the cardinals during that conclave were requested to give a little speech, each one of them, answering some basic questions, because there was no room for campaigning. You know, the election of a pope is supposed to avoid politics, so there is no campaigning. So what they did instead was to do something that would make it possible for the cardinals to become more familiar with each other by allowing them to verbalize their own vision of the church. Now, the speech delivered by Cardinal Bergoglio was made public by Cardinal Ortega of Habana, and it got Bergoglio elected as Pope Francis, apparently, because he delivered a speech that was really particularly striking. Let me return to that speech now. It was a speech in four paragraphs. Cardinal Ortega probably did not know that what he did was not supposed, was not allowed. I mean, that's what you told about the rules. But, you know, after Bergoglio gave his speech, apparently Cardinal Ortega was so impressed by the speech, he asked for a copy. And Bergoglio said, "I am sorry, I don't have a copy because it was extemporaneous." And he said, "But, you know, I can write it down for you." And apparently that night, he wrote it down and then gave it to Cardinal Ortega, who was, you know, resourceful enough to email it directly to a priest in Havana, who published it in the social media. That is why just about a day or two later, we were reading it. Did you know that evidence? But you surely heard the speech. He could not even say yes or no. He's not allowed to. Anyway, the speech was very brief. It had four short paragraphs. And it contained four basic points. Number one, what evangelizing implies. Number two, what happens when the church does not come out of herself to evangelize. Number three, what happens when the church becomes self-referential. He popularized that vocabulary of self-referentiality. And fourthly, what he expects of the next pope, without knowing that that next pope was going to be himself. All right, number one, what evangelizing implies. He says, evangelizing implies apostolic zeal. It presupposes a desire in the church to come out of herself. That's how Bergoglio understands the impulse to evangelize. It's the basic impulse to come out, for the church to come out of herself. The church, he says, is called to come out of herself, to go out to the peripheries, not only geographically, but also the existential peripheries. And now, he cites examples of the existential peripheries, the peripheries of the mystery of sin, the mystery of pain, of injustice, of ignorance, and indifference to religion, of intellectual currents, and of all misery, the mystery of misery. Secondly, when the church does not come out of herself to evangelize, he said, she becomes self-referential. And that is when the church gets sick. I'd like to propose this afternoon that the notion of parochialism is a sick notion, or a notion of a sick parish. The notion of a sick church as understood by Pope Francis or Cardinal Bergoglio. He says the evils that over time happen in ecclesial institutions have their roots in self-referentiality, a kind of theological narcissism. Wow. You know, he creates new vocabularies like this, you know? Theological narcissism. You know what narcissism is about, no? You want me to give you an example of narcissism? Are you familiar with Facebook? When you open somebody's post on Facebook and you see nothing but his faces there, you know what that means. When Pope Francis is talking about the theological equivalent of that syndrome in the church, a theological narcissism, a church turned in on itself, familiar with nothing else except churchy vocabulary. And if there are people who don't speak your vocabulary, you avoid them, you don't talk to them. Because, you know, they're not in your circle of influence. And then, he makes a reference to Pope Benedict's declaration of the year of faith. Remember, that was the time of the year of faith. And Pope Benedict came out with an apostolic letter entitled Porta Fidei. And there he quoted in the introduction, Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. Remember that passage? Here I am, here I am, I'm knocking at your door. If you open up, says the Lord, I will enter and have supper with you. Well, now Bergoglio comes up with his own commentary on Revelation 3:20. He says, in Revelation, Jesus says, he is at the door and he is knocking. Of course, we're presupposing that Jesus is outside, knocking at the door, wanting to enter. But Bergoglio said something, you know, that made his brother cardinals almost fall from their seats. Because he said, obviously the text is referring to Jesus knocking from the outside in order to enter. But I think, he said, I think about the times in which Jesus is knocking from inside so that we will let him come out. My God. It must have been shocking. Imagine him, you know, and it was in allusion to what Pope Benedict had said in Porta Fidei. I don't know how they took it. Jesus is knocking at the door of the church from within in order to get out, because we are imprisoning Jesus inside our churches. So he says, when the church is self-referential, inadvertently, she believes she has her own light. She probably believes that she is the light already. Remember the Lucifer syndrome? He says, when we become self-referential, we will not even need the light of God anymore, because we think we are the light already. She gives way to that very serious evil, he says, of spiritual worldliness. Then that means the world is no longer a temporary sojourn. It becomes a permanent thing. She lives to give glory only to herself. Now, this is all what parochialism is about. If parochial eventually assume the negative meaning, it could only mean that the negative sense of it is in reaction to this kind of church. church, which Bergoglio is describing very accurately. Put simply, he says, there are two images of the church. First, the church which evangelizes, the church that comes out of herself. And on the other hand, the worldly church, the church that is living within herself, the church that is living of herself and for herself. We've had times like these in the history of the church, when the church thought of herself as a kingdom on earth. That is why we became, you know, that's why cardinals and bishops became like princes and governors, ruling in their fiefdoms. That is why bishops' residences are called palaces. We became so worldly. So worldly. A church living within herself, of herself, for herself. This is Bergoglio. And now he ends with his expectation about the papacy. You know, it's always dangerous to make suggestions. I imagine him to be like somebody who was naively raising his hand saying, may I suggest that we do this? And then people would react and say, very good, very good, you do it. That's why they elected him Pope. And Bergoglio said, what do I expect of the next Pope? He said, he must be a man whose contemplation and adoration of Jesus Christ helps the church to go out to the existential peripheries, helps her to be the fruitful mother. A fruitful mother, meaning a prolific mother who gains life from the sweet and comforting joy of evangelizing. And so you see, Bergoglio's reflection, as shared in the conclave to his brother cardinals, was really a critique of that negative idea of the church. A critique of parochialism and the second problem, clericalism. Clericalism is to believe that the church is what the clergy makes of it. And sometimes there is even a tendency to equate church and clergy. Like I told you, when they ask people what the stand of the church is, almost always they mean what is the stand of the bishops and the priests, as if though the laity did not matter. It's a mentality that presupposes that leadership is a monopoly of the ordained. Evangelization is an exclusive task of the clergy. Who are the evangelizers? The clergy. Who are to be evangelized? The laity. So you are objects of evangelization all the time. This is clericalism. The members of the laity are objects of evangelization. The lay people do only what pastors tell them to. Yes, they can engage in apostolates, but they have no right to call them ministries. There was a very strong reaction to the use of the word ministry for what lay people are doing. For a long time, they were allowed only to use the word apostolate, meaning you do only what is mandated of you. That's why in most parishes, we're more familiar with mandated organizations than with renewal movements or communities. The vocabulary of community is not so familiar. What is familiar would be the vocabulary of mandated organization. You know, you wear the same uniform together, you wave the same banner and flag together, you know, you're happy together, you're a little club. In the context of clericalism, ministry is ordained ministry. And when you say ministry, capital letter M, uppercase ministry, God's ministry. All right. We started to accommodate the use of ministry for lay people, but we have to make sure it's lowercase. Uppercase is ordained, lowercase is lay ministries, as in minor ministries for lay volunteers. Volunteers. What is the parish pastoral council in a clericalistic perspective? I'd say, where are the priests here? Oh, marami pa rin, no? Very good. What is a PPC from a clericalistic perspective? It is just a council. What is a council? It is just an advisory body. So your role is to advise the parish priest. That's all. You don't decide. I decide. I am the parish priest. You are just an advisory body. Well, luckily, nowadays, it has become commonplace practice among parishes to create an executive committee within the parish pastoral council. That's a good development. Because when you have executive committees, they can execute. But you see, for a long time, PPCs or parish pastoral councils had no executive powers. They had no executive roles because that role of executing decisions was almost single-handedly done by the parish priest. Clericalism, right? Administration is done single-handedly by the parish priest. Even the concept of a parish finance council, that's very modern. But now we're speaking about parish finance councils, that lay people can get involved in the administration of the finances of the parish. Not all parish priests are comfortable with this. Yeah? The aspiration of the Second Vatican Council was really to restore the original sense of the Church as a community of believers, over and above being an institution or a place of worship. The catchword that we love to hear after the reform of the Church in the Second Vatican Council was active participation. That the laity are not just onlookers. The laity, they're not just, you know, quiet observers. Now we insisted on fellowship, on communion, on oneness with Christ. That when we speak of the priesthood, we have to speak first of all of the one and only priest. If you read the letter to the Hebrews, there is only one priest. That's why I usually get shivers in my spine when they call us priests. Because it's clear to us, nevertheless, that there is one unique priest in the Church, and that is Jesus Christ. And we are called to participate in that priesthood of our Lord Jesus Christ. That oneness with Christ as priest is what makes up, what builds up the Church. Because apart from Christ, we cannot be Church. You remove Christ, you don't have the Church. Apart from Christ, we can be a club. We can be an organization, an institution, but not necessarily a Church. St. Paul says in Galatians 2, I have been crucified with Christ. Beautiful definition of what it means to be a Christian. To be a Christian is to say, I have died. I have died with Christ. And the life that I now live is not my life. It is Christ alive in me. I am participating now in the life and mission of Christ. The life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. And so you see, oneness with the priesthood of Christ is the foundation of being church. In the Second Vatican Council, that oneness with the priesthood of Christ is given a beautiful term, the common priesthood of the faithful. Let me just call attention to this. The common priesthood of the faithful. Because sometimes people talk about the common priesthood of the laity. That's wrong. That's a misnomer. You'll never hear about the common priesthood of the laity. It's a common priesthood of the faithful. The faithful, the community of the baptized. And that includes all of us, the clergy, the religious, the laity. We share in that common priesthood by the grace of baptism. Because we're baptized into Christ. We're grafted into the life of the priest. Because we are baptized or immersed into Christ, we become priestly. We become participants in that priesthood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, what about the priesthood of the ordained? Well, the Second Vatican Council now uses the word ministry, to refer to the priesthood of the ordained. We are entering into the sacred order, which is a ministry, a very specific ministry of leadership in the community of Christ on behalf of the one head of the church. The one head of the church that is Christ. So it is a representative leadership. Meaning, in the church, we always take for granted that anyone who leads on behalf of the one and only leader of the church, which is Christ. And so leadership is sacramental. In the truest and the most beautiful sense of the word, sacramental. Sacrament means sign and instrument. You're a sign of that leadership, but also an instrument of that leadership of Christ. The word that is used, or the term or the expression that is used by the Second Vatican Council for this ministerial priesthood of the ordained is agere in persona Christi capitis ecclesiae, to act in the person of Christ, the head of his body, the church. Meaning, a representative kind of headship. And so this ministerial priesthood is distinguished from the common priesthood by the Second Vatican Council. One is ordered towards the other, meaning the common priesthood is our common participation as members of the body of Christ in the one priesthood of Christ. And so it's important to know that the ordained have no monopoly of the priesthood of Christ. That's always been clear. If we forget that, we become clericalistic all over again. Every baptized individual who becomes a member of Christ, becomes part of the Supreme High Priest, and becomes priestly. That is what we refer to as the common priesthood of the faithful. We don't have a monopoly of that priesthood. The important and the most fundamental participation is not even ordination. The most fundamental participation in the priesthood of Christ is baptism. Baptism. The priesthood of the ordained serves mainly to build up the common priesthood of the faithful, not to monopolize it. And so if the ordained become clericalistic and are not able to allow the laity to participate in that one priesthood of Christ, they are forfeiting their roles. They are not doing what they're supposed to be doing. Otherwise, we're not being faithful to our role in the church. Saint Augustine was very clear about this. He said, "For you, I am a bishop. With you, I am a Christian." You know, the "with you," that is by the grace of baptism. The "for you," that is the sacrament, that is the grace of the ordination. St. Augustine himself says, "With you, or for you, I may be a bishop, but with you, I am a Christian. If I cannot be a Christian with you, I cannot be a bishop for you. If I cannot be a fellow Christian with you, I cannot be a good ordained minister for you." Dear brother priests, I hope you don't forget that. The "with you" is the foundation of the "for you." The "for you" makes no sense if you remove the "with you." Our common unity with Christ should manifest itself in our common unity with one another in the church. And the foundation of that unity is the same Spirit whom we have received. That unity in the Spirit is what we call communion, because we have been made to drink of the same Spirit. We are breathing the breath of God as parts of the body of Christ. And so let me now move to the clergy-lay collaboration. Let me begin by asking the question, collaboration in what? Obviously, it's collaboration in the mission of the church. Now you're talking in a clericalistic paradigm, in a clericalistic worldview. There is no such thing as participation. What you have is monopoly. Evangelization is the exclusive business of the ordained. Says who? That is not in keeping with our theology. Mission goes in two directions. This part I have shared with some of you in the Couples for Christ. I think it was it last year or 2 years ago? 2 years ago. Let me refresh your memory about this part. Mission in the church has two directions, ad intra and ad extra, inward and outward. Ad intra, I call that the inward mission. When you say, "I want to serve the church," in whatever capacity, "I want to serve the church," that's participation in mission ad intra. When we serve the church in our individual capacities, as clergy, religious, laity, hoping that on the strength of the gift of the Spirit, we now exercise a ministry, because a ministry is supposed to be a charism that builds up the church. When the charism that you have received from the Holy Spirit builds up only your individuality, you don't call that a ministry. It is a ministry when it builds up the church. There is no monopoly of ministry. And I am glad that we're back to the category of ministries in the plural. That the ministry of leadership is an important ministry, but should not lord it over all the other ministries. It is one ministry, but it is not the only ministry. It's one of many forms of service in the church. It's an important ministry, of course. The role of the ordained ministry is to evoke the variety of ministries bestowed by the Spirit on the church, not suppress them. Because if the ordained ministers, if the clerics suppress the other ministries, then they're not being true to their ministry. The ministry of the ordained is precisely to coordinate. That is why we are called episcopoi. You know, the word episcopos is a coordinator, an overseer, who wants to make sure that the church is kept in communion. In communion. Who wants to make sure that the gifts of the Spirit are evoked and activated and are put in the service of the body of Christ? What about the outward mission? Ad extra. When we say, as part of the church, we want to be of service to the world, do we want to be of service to society? Well, the summary for that is what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, 13 to 14. It's the summary of the mission of the church. I'm not talking about the mission of the clergy. I'm not talking about the mission of missionary congregations. I think nowadays, you know, some missionary congregations are beginning to have some kind of a dilemma about the definition of mission, because they are coming to realize that mission is not about missionary congregations, it's about the whole church. If you call yourself a missionary, the question is, who sent you? Whom do you represent? Missionary is representing the church. A missionary is being sent by the church. And so if you call yourself a missionary, you better make it clear to yourself who's sending you. You are the salt of the earth. You're the light of the world, says Jesus. All of us members of the church are participants in this mission. In the Second Vatican Council, Gaudium et Spes, that beautiful document, is concerned about the church serving the world, the church in the modern world. We're not supposed to behave like ghettos. We're not supposed to behave like exclusive fellowships who care only about each other. To be Catholic is to believe that God cares for the whole world. To be Catholic is to believe that God intends the salvation not just of Catholics. Because I think if you believe that God cares only for Catholics, that's the clearest sign that you're not Catholic. To be Catholic is to believe that God's love is for all. For all. Not just for the righteous, by the way. There used to be a time when the Jewish people believed that there will be salvation only for the righteous and damnation for all sinners. The revolution of Christianity precisely lies in the belief that God is not too eager to condemn sinners. And we read in the Gospel of John, for God so loved the world, He gave us His only Son, so that all who believe might not perish, but might have eternal life. God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world. So why are we so afraid of God, like God is going to condemn us at any moment? You remember Romans chapter 8? If God is for us, who can be against us? Who can separate us from the love of God? Do you really believe that God intends to condemn you. No, God intends to save you. This is the revolution of Christianity. God intends to save not just the good people, but sinners as well. So you cannot think of a thing more inclusive than Christianity. That's why Christianity should be innately Catholic, because Catholicism is about inclusiveness. Very often we tend to limit the church's mission to ministry. And by that we mean the inward mission, the inward mission. They say, what is your ministry? I am a lector. What is your ministry? I am a part of the choir of the music ministry. Let me tell you a story. When I was a young minor seminarian in Pampanga, one day, the Dean of Studies asked us a question. He said, may I know how many of you have parents who are volunteers in the church and members of mandated organizations? Raise your hands. I looked around, they all raised their hands, and I did not. Because my parents were not members of any mandated organization. They were not, you know, regular volunteers in the church. We would come to church on Sunday, but because we're 13 children, I have 6 brothers and 6 sisters. They were quite busy with the family. And I talked to my mother, I said, Ma, maybe you should join Catholic Women's League. Because I might get a fading grade, you know, from the Dean of Studies. You know what my mother said? She said, Ambo, listen to me. Talk to that priest. You tell him that I have 13 children. And we receive each one of them as a gift from God. We don't have a housemate at home. The fact that we could still go to church together as a family is already a big deal for me. And you ask me to spend many hours volunteering as a member of the Catholic Women's League when I have to look after 30 children? You don't call that mission? That's parochialism. It is parochial to think that you're serving the church only by volunteering to ministries in the church. My father, he was a lawyer. And even on a Sunday, he would have consultations with people who could not afford a lawyer. But nobody ever told me that he was participating in the mission of the church by doing so. Because I thought that ministry had always to be churchy. That's parochialism. All Christians, clergy, religious, laity, meaning the faithful together, all of us share in the threefold mission of Christ as priest, prophet, and king. And we are all familiar with the aspects of the church's mission, the priestly or sanctifying ministry, the prophetic or the witnessing ministry, the kingly, the servant leadership ministry. And we are all somehow performing some of these ministries in our communities. We call them ministries of formation, worship, service. The problem, however, is, as defined, they all tend to be inwardly directed to serve the church, to serve the parish. Our messianic task is to be a community of disciples. Okay, that's why we build discipleship. That's why we build communities. That is why we keep our communities in communion with each other. It's okay even if our communities divide. As long as we are still in communion with each other. It's dangerous to divide when the division leads to a schism. A division is not necessarily a schism. If you divide, because after dividing, you diversify your ministries, that leads to growth. Especially if at some point you begin to embrace each other again and remain in communion because you receive the same Lord Jesus Christ in the Eucharist. You cannot possibly hate each other. And call yourself Christian. Brothers and sisters, 2 days from now, I'm going to be addressing the other group. And it was by some accident, because I was invited, you know, by your organizers, and I put it already in my calendar. And then the secretary said, "Bishop, the CFC is asking what your response is to their invitation." I said yes to that already. And she said, okay, so I would say yes. It's on June 23. And I said, is that the same day? I was confused. Anyway, I said yes to that already. I was saying yes to another group. It's a good accident. God must have a message. And believe it or not, a few days ago, somebody called me up wanting to donate a piece of land to the Diocese of Caloocan. And I met with them in a restaurant. And then I said, "Oh, you're members of the CFC?" And they said, "Well, the other one." "Oh," I said, "you're members of the FFL? And they said, "Still the other one." "Oh," I said, "there's another one." No problem. The more, the merrier. As long as we remain in communion. The church is a communion of communities. That's why we need leaders. That's why parish priests must keep the different organizations together. That's why bishops must keep parish priests together. That's why the conference must keep the dioceses together. That's why the FABC must keep the Asian conferences of bishops together. That's why the Holy Father must keep us all together. He is our symbol of communion. For us, communion comes on many levels. To make sure that even if we are many, we remain one. Because we belong to the same body of Christ and we receive the same body. So please get rid of whatever bitterness, hatred, resentment there might be. Do not hurt the body of Christ. At extra, let me end up with that extra. We are called not just to be a community of the saved, but a saving community. We are called to serve the church. But that is not all there is to it. We are called not just to serve the church, but to serve the world as part of a servant church. If we know only how to serve the church, that might still be self-referential. What effect do we have in the world? To be a servant like Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for the many. For the laity, this mission includes culture, economics, and politics, namely the just ordering of the world. You know, there is always the twofold problem of the clericalization of the laity and the laicization of the clergy. Both are negative. If politics is about good governance, the laity must do all they can to evangelize politics, to actively participate in governance, in the promotion of the common good, informed by the gospel, and informed by the social teachings of the church. That is why I cannot see why one thing to provide decent housing for the poor is not a church concern. I cannot see why one thing to answer the cry of the poor is not a church concern. I know the doctor. I know why there was a parting of ways between GK and CFC. But I wish we can re-establish connections somehow. Because that is an extra. We're not only a church serving ourselves, we're a church serving the world, especially the poorest of the poor, the last of the least, and the lost. The ordained are agents of communion of communities, providing the goal, the direction, assuring fidelity to the vision and mission of Christ. The laity are called to be actively involved in this world, working for the renewal of this world, but motivated not by worldly values, but otherworldly values. The laity are called to be models as parents, as family heads, as people engaged in business, as educators, as lawyers, as doctors, scientists, technocrats, politicians, employers, employees, etc. Let me end with a little quotation from Pope Paul VI. Let's read that together. Modern people listen more to witnesses than to teachers. Really? Does that mean they don't listen to teachers anymore? Well, not exactly, he says. And so, the second line is, can we read it? Thank you. I'd like to end my share with you.